Today we're going to be talking about game flavor. So obviously we're not talking about, you know, your favorite flavor of ice cream. This is really more about...
Don't eat the CD.
Yeah, don't eat the CD, right? This is just more about when you're immersed in a gaming environment, how do you create a world that players feel is immersive, not just in terms of how you're telling your narrative or your linear story, but the things that you might even name a specific menu item or the way that your player transitions through the world environment in a way that just seems to feel right for this immersive experience that you've created. So, Mike, what are some good examples of game flavor, and what can game developers and designers really do some pre-planning and pre-thinking before they start to even get into development to try to think about how they develop this flavorful world?
Yeah, so we're talking about things that don't have to do with the actual game mechanics. We're talking about things that make you forget you're playing a video game and make you think that you're thematically in whatever context the game is. So
sure.
If it's a war game, you feel like you're in a battle, or if it's a game where you're, you know, exploring, you want to feel like that. And these can be very, very simple things, just like naming an item something different. So instead of calling it a menu, you call it a scroll. And when you hit the menu button, which isn't going to be called that, instead of having a square show up with buttons on it, it looks like a textured paper scroll.
Right.
It has words on it because you're in some sort of fantasy world. Or if you're playing a game that's a construction game, maybe it's a clipboard with some paper
clipboard.
On it, some checks. And we've all seen games where this happens. And the interesting thing is you usually don't really notice it because you're not supposed to notice it. As a game designer or developer, you're trying to think ahead and think about how you take all of the elements that are obviously part of a board game or a video game, and you replace the text with something that sounds a little bit different. Instead of having a button that says resign, you have a button that says surrender, or something like that. And you have games that are board games like Clue, where everybody gets a little notepad that they can write on, you know, rather than just a piece of paper.
It has
a sort of texture to it. Or in a video game, everything is renamed. You don't have menus. You have something else, you know.
I like what you're talking about with menus, because something I'm starting to see on kind of the cutting edge of games, and maybe there are even some games that have tried this in the past, and a lot of times for game developers and designers, really, really, you know, futuristic thinking designers may actually be ahead of where players are in terms of even be able to absorb some of these types of aspects. And one of them is a free-flowing or free-floating menu, where it's not even a menu. You're immediately immersed in a world, and your, you know, your opening screen or your entry screen is actually a probable, a movable environment. So instead of, you know, in some blockchain concepts I've seen, you're automatically just in a screen when you log in with your wallet. And if you want to go over to the marketplace, your character has to walk or travel to what looks like a marketplace. And then you can engage with different aspects of the game that are giving you that feedback from that marketplace level. So it's taking it from the non-linear perspective of clicking through each menu down or working levels down, the way a lot of Web 2 websites were created in the past as well, because we think very linearly when that's how our stack of code is developed. Now we have the ability to think more universally and create a better immersive experience for players when they don't have to just keep clicking down and down and down, but it can be more of an immersive environment. You can apply this to, hey, if it's a shipping and, you know, coastal exploration game, you start out at a port and then you sail to different parts of this, you know, closed world that then allows you to access parts of an open world that are behind these kind of ports in your game. So that's just an example.
Yeah, and we're also talking about trying to disguise the game mechanics that are in your game.
Right.
So if you have something like monetary transactions or cryptocurrency transactions, you don't want people to think that they're going to a PayPal page.
Right.
You want them to think, and so you can just think about what you're even calling this part of the game, what you're calling this screen. And if it's a game that's, you know, a pirate game, you might talk about, you know, going to port to sell our wares or something, you know. And you change the visuals and the text appropriately.
Of course.
So that people don't think, oh, I'm playing a game. They're distracted from that.
Well, and I love too when game designers and developers think outside the box, beyond the traditional, or at least their necessary stack. Where, you know, we play a lot of games like Civ or Rome Total War, where a pop up might just come as part of your notifications that, hey, it's 1492 and the new world has been discovered, and it's like a bulletin, and it
doesn't even change anything. It's just.
Yeah,
it's just text that shows up that...
Yeah, there's no change to you as the player. It just helps create this immersive experience. As much as you have games, you know, where especially in the blockchain space now, where it allows you to use current modern terms like you're talking about for, let's say, staking or mining, where you could design and develop a whole game around, you know, dwarves mining jewels and gems, and that connects to this entire, you know, cryptocurrency payments aspect of what you're talking about. And I think that's really important for game designers, lore creators, writers, storytellers that are involved in the game development.
And artists as well.
And artists to think about what are going to be those things that are going to set my experience and immersive world that I'm creating apart for players in a way that they, like you said, forget that they're playing a video game, that they're in their own, you know, own environments of their home or wherever they're playing with other players. And now they're really in this new world.
Yeah, in a lot of games, you know, that if you had a turn-based game, instead of having turn one, turn two, you could have year one, year two.
Sure. Well, that's it for us today. Thanks so much for joining us. This has been Game Brainz.
Bye.